Mr. Speaker.
The Honourable Damien O'Connor.
Mr. Speaker, a minor technical amendment bill. Yes. Well, we've heard that in this House so often, Mr. Speaker. And those of us who have been around for a wee while tend to look a little suspiciously at such statements. I listened to the Minister and I had to agree with some of her statements, Mr. Speaker, although not all. Land underpins everything, she said. Now, that's partly true, I guess, if you're lucky enough to have some land. Mr. Speaker, it attracts overseas investment. Well, that's true as well. Mr. Speaker, this is more than just a minor technical amendment to a piece of legislation. It comes off the back of a recommendation from the Law Commission made in 2010, so an independent body that comes to the House with recommendations, a bit like the Parliamentary Commissioner for the Environment, although the government seems to ignore those recommendations. Mr. Speaker, I just want to go back as a member of a committee that had a look and oversight on Land Online, the technical electronic system that we have. It cost us a fortune, to be fair. Huge cost blowout, and now we are making some minor technical amendments to ensure that it operates properly. We have to, in opposition, Mr. Speaker, acknowledge that as time moves on, technology certainly has, and some of these issues will, or the changes will be required to ensure that we can retain, I guess, the property rights, not to the extent that the ACT Party might proclaim. We're not that ridiculous. We're not that Neanderthal in our thinking. There are new nuances around ownership, such as lessees, leases, that I referred to in this bill that I'm not going to get into, Mr. Speaker. I come back to the issue raised by my colleagues as to why this bill is going through now. And there are some quite technical issues here that and things that are being changed that will have far-reaching implications, some of which we won't raise or realise in this House today. But those people who are out around the world, to quote the Minister, who might be attracted to New Zealand for overseas investment, they'll be looking very carefully at this. And the member over there who nods his head is probably quite happy to protect the rights of those people who are going to want to come and invest in New Zealand. I have a greater concern, and that is for New Zealanders who currently have the land, or New Zealand families that want to keep and retain the land. The facts are, we're under pressure. In 1985, when I was a share milker, Mr. Speaker, I remember going to a rally against the then Labor government and being told that farmers should farm for productive returns and not for capital gains. The unfortunate thing is, fuelled and encouraged by the banks, by the government, by Dairy NZ, the farmers have ploughed huge amounts of capital into land, arguably to the point where land values are unsustainable. And just as leaders of the dairy industry say that actually production levels around the world are unsustainable, that's about as true as saying that New Zealand land values are unsustainable. And the question for Kiwis and for a New Zealand government is, which one should give in first? Which one is going to cave in first? That is, will it be the foreign production of milk all around the world that's swamping us at the moment? Or will it be the unrealistic land values of farmers up and down this country? Mr. Speaker, my colleague David Cunliffe points out to the truth. The banks have walked away with billions of dollars of profit, billions of dollars of profit. And what we have now is a whole lot of thousands, literally, not the 10% that John Key wants to refer to, actually probably closer to 50% of farmers who are under real financial pressure now. And the issue of land values is crucial to their future, good or bad. The reality is that unless the banks and the government leave the door open to that foreign investment, we are likely to see a downward adjustment of up to 40% of land values in this country. That is a frightening scenario for too many farmers up and down this country. I suggest, not as part of a conspiracy, Mr. Speaker, but just part of normal modus operandi for the National Tory government, that they want to tidy up these technical details, which is why this bill's in the House now, to ensure that the foreign investors, and there are millions of them around the world, who would love to come and invest in this country. And the member over there is shaking his head. Get his head out of the sand. Why would you come and invest in New Zealand? Well, there's a couple of reasons, Mr. Speaker. Firstly, if you want to put your money in the European Central Bank, you'll have a negative interest rate of 0.4%. That is, you will be paying them to look after your money. If you want to come and invest in New Zealand, you can buy land, enjoy capital gain without any taxation, and most likely see further upward movement of land values if the door's left open to further speculation from offshore investors. Mr. Speaker, the government's caught in a bind here between its constituencies, as was said before, between the bankers who have got very high exposure to our land values around this country, and they want to secure that as best they can, and farmers who are indebted as well. There'll be a downward adjustment of 40%, which will mean potentially massive sales, which will mean this piece of legislation is absolutely crucial to protect the property rights of those selling and those purchasing, of those who might be leasing or subleasing. And I'm assuming that the minor technical amendments that we're talking about here actually do protect the property rights of people coming or going. But my concern is for those farmers who might be going, or in future, those farmers or wannabe farmers who won't be able to acquire the land. Mr. Speaker, we are facing a major issue. The timing of this legislation is just a little too cute for my liking. While I haven't been and won't be on the Select Committee, Mr. Speaker, I will be following this closely, because if we don't get this right, and if the National Government and the banks are quite prepared to see the massive sellout of foreign land in this country, of land to foreigners in this country, Mr. Speaker, we will be, as John Key said and preached, tenants in our own land. Under his government, endorsed by his government and that minister, she's quite happy because she's acknowledged in her speech that the robust and secure land tenure in this country, Mr. Speaker, that goes back to something that we took from the Australians. We've got to be suspicious of that in the first place. But we took it from then back in the 1800s. We've refined it, and this bill will further refine. But let's not get distracted by minor technical amendments when the underlying agenda of the government to satisfy its mates offshore wants to be seen as open and welcoming to foreign investment. The banks, because they want to save any potential loss from a downward valuation of farmland around this country. And the poor farmers who are stuck in the middle, Mr. Speaker, who have been encouraged to go out and invest huge amounts in land values on the basis and the false promise of high dairy payouts, Mr. Speaker. Those farmers are caught out. We need to support them. We need to support them, not with money, but with a fair deal and a fair process. I'm not convinced that this piece of legislation does anything to protect the fair process. We are told it will. I'm suspicious that it might be more about protecting the property rights of those who might come in from offshore. Mr. Speaker, I'm in this House, as is the Labor Party, for one reason and one reason only. And that's first and foremost to look after New Zealanders, people who want to come to this country, commit to this country, and generate wealth. I'm not here to look after foreign overseas speculators who might want to come in and off the backs of poor farmers invest in property that they get free capital gains off, Mr. Speaker. And if this piece of legislation supports and enhances and helps them, then we're not for it. But if it does support the property rights in the place of New Zealand
farmers, I'm sorry to interrupt the Honourable Member. His time has expired.